So the next subject which we need to study is artificial intelligence. To start the subject, first of all, we need to discuss what is artificial intelligence. What do you mean by artificial intelligence? Can you give a formal definition to artificial intelligence? And what are the future scopes, applications and things which you can do with this particular subject? Now see, this subject is not a new subject. There are other branches of computer science which are fairly new. Like we have neural networks, we have even fuzzy logic, which is fairly new. And even the subject like theory of computation, they are a new subjects. But artificial intelligence subject, this subject was with us from a very long time. And where we need to understand that, can we impart some human-like capabilities to the computer system so that the computer system should be able to think like a human being? And see, we started this subject when in around 1930s, 1920s, people started to see, can we devise a system or can we devise a machine which can think like human being? But that time, the knowledge of computational power, or you can say the scientist was not having the enough knowledge about the computational power, or you can say computational complexities of different problems. But now, in the current scenario, current age, we understand the computational complexities, the computational power in a very depth as compared to the previous case, that we have the better knowledge of computations and the computational power of our systems. Now, when they devised the subject artificial intelligence, now in 1950s, a very famous scientist, Alan Turing, who introduced the Turing machine for cracking the Enigma code. I think you've already seen the movie related to this. So he said that we can say a system is intelligent if it can behave like a human being. And for that he proposed a test, and that test was called as a Turing test. And the Turing test, what they say is, we have a computer in a closed room and there's an interrogator which is sitting outside that particular room. Interrogator is asking some kind of questions from the computer, and the computer should be able to answer those questions in such a way that the interrogator should not be able to identify whether there's a human being who is answering the question or whether there's a computer who is answering the question. And this particular computer is having some capabilities which is human-like capabilities, that it should be able to think, it should be able to process information, and it should be able to accept some kind of inputs, and then it should be able to give some kind of outputs. And those outputs can be categorized into several different things. Like initially, it was very difficult for us to think that whether a computer should be able to deceive a person in games like chess. Because chess was considered as one of the most difficult games, and people used to think that computer will not be able to play chess because it requires a lot of understanding of the things, how the other person is thinking, or what are the kind of moves you need to take, etc. But later on, in 1970s, 80s, we introduced some new programs for playing chess, which was actually very, very fairly simple programs, right? So we introduced those programs so that a computer or the machine should be able to play games like chess with a human being, and it defeated the then world champion for the chess, grandmaster of the chess. And so for accepting some kind of input, the computer should be having some kind of capabilities for natural language processing. Natural language processing means, for example, if you and me, we are talking. When we are talking, we are having our conversation in natural language, whether it is English, whether it is Hindi, and our brain takes that information, it processes that information to give some kind of output from that particular information. Now, to accept the input from the computer, it is important and it is necessary so that the computer should be able to process information in a human-like manner. It should be take the input from the human in a human-like manner, it should be process the input, it should be able to understand the input, and then it should be able to give the output from that particular input. But some people are not convinced this particular fact, and they introduced one more test, and that test was called as Chinese room argument. And this Chinese room argument is such that a system, a computer system, is inside a room, and is that, or you can say person is inside the room rather than saying computer system, you can say person is inside the room, which is called as the operator, and he's having a very big book which is related to the Chinese literature. It should be able to give some kind of solutions, or you can say answers to the problems which are asked by the interrogator about from that book. It should be processed that and should be give that output. Now there are two different meanings of this. Number one, if there's a person who is sitting outside, then if he's asking some questions, now this operator who is sitting inside the room, he takes those questions in Chinese, it checks or it matches the similar kind of questions from the book or because of the Chinese literature, and then based on that it processes the information to get give some output to that particular person. But it does not mean that that person is having a clear-cut understanding of the language. Now there are two things. Number one, there's a cognition, and second one is the understanding. Cognition means you should be able to recognize it, you should be able to check from the book whether there's a particular output or there's some answers given to that particular problem. And understanding means that you are able to deduce information, you are able to understanding the basic meanings of that particular language, or the meaning, when I'm saying meaning, that you should be able to understand it like human-like fashion, and then you should be able to give some information or process that particular information from this particular particular questions. Okay, that is the Chinese room argument. Now, there are multiple areas where these computer systems are, if we are using them effectively, and this artificial intelligence is, they're used very much in a lot of different domains to solve different kind of problems, to deduce knowledge, to gather new knowledge. Already, if you have already available knowledge, then it should be able to process that knowledge to give some kind of new knowledge out of it. Now, the most basic fundamental thing, or I can say the most basic requirement for artificial intelligence, that you should be able to solve the problems. Then problems can be anything. Like initially, it was very difficult for the human to write a program related to how to search or how to sort from a given array. Now we know a lot of algorithms which are there. We know at least 5 to 10 algorithms to sort some data or to search from a given data. Now, it should be, when I'm saying the artificial intelligence system, it should be able to deduce, or it should be able to find some new ways to solve a particular problem. It can be using trial and error method, and those kind of problems, they have a certain kind of characteristics. When I'm saying certain kind of characteristics, that means those kind of problems are very much computationally hard. And we already know there are different kind of computationally difficult problems which are categorized in form of NP, NP complete and NP hard. I know that there are two types of problems. There's a P problem, there's an NP problem. We discussed about these kind of problems in algorithms, as well as we discussed about these kind of algorithms in theory of computation like subjects. Now, when I'm saying P type of problem, that means these are the kind of problems which can be solved in polynomial time. And when I'm saying NP type of problem, that means these are the kind of problems which can be verified in polynomial time, but it does not matter, or it does not mean that they can be solved in polynomial time. Solving a problem in polynomial time and verifying the problem in polynomial time, there are two different things. Even if you cannot solve the problem in polynomial time, but still you can verify it in polynomial time. Like, you know the example of traveling salesman problem. Now that traveling salesman problem, even if you use different programming paradigms, whether it is dynamic programming, still you will not be able to solve that problem in polynomial time. No one has ever proved it, but we consider that we'll not be able to solve it in polynomial time, because till now, from the very long time, people are trying to prove whether P is equal to NP or not, and this one of the NP hard problems, that is a traveling salesman problem. Now we consider that maybe this is the case, but we cannot prove it. Maybe this is the case that no one will be able to solve the problem in polynomial time, but still there exist proofs or whether if you already solved the problem, there exist proofs which should be verified, which should be able to verify that whether this particular solution is correct or not, or you can say there's a polynomial time verification algorithm which does exist. And when I'm saying, in case of artificial intelligence, when I'm saying that system should be able to solve the problems, now there are some different characteristics of those problems. Like, for example, we'll be having some kind of state, space and time trade-off, like we have for sorting algorithms. If space increases, then time decreases. If time increases, then space decreases. That is called a space-time trade-off. And we should be able to accelerate the process using the already acquired knowledge, or using that already acquired knowledge, we should be able to find proofs or deduce solutions to the problem. That is called as heuristics. Just now that understand that there are different paradigms of problems. We know that there's a problem which are linear programming problem, which are very hard problems. Then people should think that no one is able to solve the linear programming problem. Then we solved the linear programming problems. Then we introduced the new types of, you know, new types of paradigms, which are for integer programming. Then from integer programming, we introduced which is dynamic programming. We have studied the dynamic programming extensively in the subject algorithms. And then we introduced the problems related to the heuristic search problems. Okay, and these heuristic search problems are, you know, difficult rather than the dynamic programming, where the dynamic programming is more inclined towards the optimality. Optimality means that we should be able to optimize something. Like we have 0-1 knapsack, where we are trying to optimize, we are trying to get the maximum profit from a given space. In the same way, we have the matrix chain multiplication problem, and we have where we are trying to see what is the minimum number of multiplications are required to multiply two matrices. We have longest common subsequence problem, where we are trying to see that given two sequence strings, will you be able to find a sequence which is longest of all the sequences which are present between these two strings. So for solving these kind of problems, there are dynamic programming problems, but still not just solving the problem is not enough. Then we should be able to deduce the knowledge, we should be able to deduce the concepts from particular knowledge. That is really, really important. Now just let me just give you a very simple example. In the past, there are a lot of problems which cannot be solved by human being, because those problems are very huge in nature. For example, if you see for in graph algorithm, there's a five-color theorem and there's a four-color theorem. For the four-color theorem, it says that given a graph, any graph, whether you take a graph of any country, whether you take a graph of anything, it should be a planar graph, but it should be a planar graph. Given a planar graph, what is the minimum number of colors required to color all the regions in the graph in such a way that no two adjacent regions are having the same color? They should be having different colors. And we need to identify what is the minimum number of colors required to color the graph. And there's for a very long time, there's no mathematical proof to it, but we knew that maybe it is the number of colors, maybe four, that we should be able to color the entire graph with four colors if it is a planar graph, right? So there's no mathematical proof was not there. But then when the computer system evolved, when the computational power evolved, then we introduced new methods to solve that particular problem. We have taken huge amount of inputs, we have taken large amount of input, we given that input to process it with to the computer, and that computer processed it, and then with large amount of very huge inputs, we identified, we proved that yes, only four colors are required or only five colors are required to color the graphs. So there are two variants of this, the graph coloring problem. But number one is you want to color the vertices, and what is the minimum number of colors required to color all the vertices so that no two adjacent vertices are having the same color. And second one, you want to color the regions. That means no two regions are, you know, should have the same kind of colors. Now, when I'm seeing this, solving this kind of problems, it is very easy because you are just giving some inputs. It should be able to process that particular input. It should be able to say that yes, you will be able to do this in four colors, or no, you will not be able to do this in four colors. Now, mathematically, using this computational power, we proved it. But mathematicians did not accept it because they need a more formal definition, or because a more formal proofs rather than just giving some inputs and processing with those inputs, because the number of inputs we have taken for this kind of graph, this kind of problem is very, very huge. And they're so huge that even if a process, a human being is trying to verify whether those solutions are correct or not, he needs hundreds of years to verify those problems. So we need the computers, we need the artificial intelligence. Now artificial intelligence still from that particular solution, from that particular proof, then we introduce some simple steps which are formal steps to prove that there are how many colors are required to color a given graph. That is just a very simple example that in that area the artificial intelligence was used to prove some kind of theorems or to give proof of the theorems or to give proof of the problems which are already existing. That is still one more area of artificial intelligence. That means we are trying to deduce knowledge from the already existing system. Now there are four different domains of this. Number one is we have knowledge-based system. Number one. Number two, we have expert systems. Number three, we have automated theorem provers. Number four, we have formal verifications of these problems. When I'm saying knowledge-based system means we are trying to identify how to retrieve, store and retrieve knowledge. Number two, how to interpret facts, rules and how to be able to deduce knowledge from a given data. And number three, can we bridge the gap between the knowledge and the realization of that knowledge? And number four, what are the logics which you used in those knowledge? And this knowledge may be very, very huge. Trust me, it will be very, very huge. Now, when I'm saying there are knowledge, logics to deduce the knowledge, logics means if there already existing some knowledge base, now you should be able to take the help of the propositional calculus or predicate calculus to prove certain things. That we already studied that other thing in discrete mathematics, the first chapter of discrete mathematics for Kenneth Rosenberg or any, you know, any generally when you study discrete mathematics, the first chapter for the discrete mathematics is the propositional logic or propositions. Now, using the propositional logic, we can create new, we can generate new knowledge, we can deduce new knowledge. There are multiple theorems for this. There is a modus ponens theorem, there is a modus tollens theorem. We use them to deduce knowledge. In the same way, this entire subject can be categorized into multiple parts, like a lot of things which include together to make one subject. For example, we have neural networks, we have fuzzy networks, we have different kind of, probabilistic network, probabilistic knowledge, like we know that there's a Bayes theorem. Now using that Bayes theorem, we try to prove something, what is the probability of doing something, and accordingly we try to gather or give some kind of knowledge from this. So this artificial intelligence system, again I'm saying, it is a subject where we try to give human-like thinking capabilities to the computer system, and for these purposes we are going to take a lot of aid from this computer system about so that it should be able to take the knowledge, in natural language processing, in natural language, or it should be able to give output from that knowledge to the human beings. So let us discuss about what are the topics which we need to cover for this subject, and some of those topics are common with the neural network, some of those topics are common with the fuzzy logics, and we will discuss all that in this subject. Now, the syllabus of the subject is as follows. We are going to study, number one, the first part is what are the problems and search, where we are going to study what is artificial intelligence. Then we'll be studying problems, spaces and search, where we are going to define the problems as a state space search, then production systems, problem characteristics, etc. Then we'll be studying what are the heuristic search techniques, where we'll be studying about generate and test hill climbing, best first search, problem reduction, constraint satisfaction, etc. And then the second part will be the knowledge representation, where we are going to study the knowledge representation issues, and then we'll be studying what is using the predicate knowledge to represent simple facts in logics. Then we are going to study about the presenting knowledge using rules, symbolic reasoning under uncertainty. Then statistical reasoning is there, and a part of this will be studying what is game playing, planning, understanding, this small part which is natural language processing, which we don't need to study for this examination, for the UGC NET examination, but for other courses we are going to cover it. So I'm going to make courses based on this. There's a separate course which will be after this course, which is about creating intelligent systems. We are going to have simple examples of like creating a chatbot, about a chatbot is going to chat with a human being and it should be able to reply to the human being, like a Turing test. And then we are also going to study about the perception and actions and expert system, fuzzy logics, generic algorithms, and neural networks, etc., etc. So whatever we are going to study, that is for this artificial intelligence subject, there is a mixture of neural networks, there is a mixture of soft computing, artificial intelligence, so that it is kind of a soft computing, you can say, the artificial intelligence, neural networks, and the fuzzy logics. So it is kind of a soft computing for this. So let's do one thing, let us dig into the subject, and we will discuss about all these things in detail in the later part of videos. But I think you have a clear-cut idea as what is a artificial intelligence system. That is, it should be able to think like human being, it should be able to solve problems like human being, it should be able to, we should be able to deduce more complex problems which may not be solvable by human beings in the coming period. Okay, so now let us look into this and let us dig deep into this subject.